Good afternoon and welcome to Captives with Pete Woodring and Scott Hamilton. In today's presentation, Scott Hamilton from InnoVision will be discussing why to use a captive insurance company and who are the best candidates. Before we start today's call, here are a few housekeeping items. We will break for questions at the end of the call today, and there are two ways you can ask a question. On your GoToWebinar toolbar, there is a hand icon. You can click on that and you can ask the question to the group. We will unmute you and then you can ask it. You also may type in questions in the chat box, which is on the toolbar as well. Today's program is being recorded and we will publish for viewing later on. Our goal in the call is to provide you with the highest level of service and expertise possible and to remind you that we are available as a resource to help you succeed. Please welcome Pete Woodring from Cypress Partners to the line. Good afternoon, Pete.
Hi, thank you. Thank you, everybody, for joining the call today, taking the time to join us. I'm a co-founder and principal of Cypress Partners. We're a wealth consulting practice, and we specialize in engineering portfolios, financial planning and engineering portfolios for our clients. We also act as their personal CFOs and help them with all other facets of their wealth plans, such as estate planning, insurance planning, tax planning, education planning, social security planning, philanthropic planning, you name it, and specialty vehicles such as captive insurance. And that conversation is coming up more and more with some of our business owner clients, so I thought this would be a great opportunity to introduce Scott Hamilton, the captive insurance specialist and planner who we've partnered with to explain some of the great benefits of captive insurance and how your companies might be able to benefit from such a vehicle. Scott?
Thanks, Pete, and again, welcome to the call. Today we're going to go through a fairly high level of captives. This is probably a subject that you could spend certainly hours on and probably longer getting into the details, but today what we'd like to try and do is cover some of the high-level concepts, some of the benefits for doing a captive, who might be a good prospect, what type of company, what type of ownership structure. We're going to look at a case study, maybe even one or two as we go through this, so that you get some sense of how this all works. We'll look at some risk examples, some of the things that people have insured in other companies to give you an idea of what might be possible in your world. We'll take a look at some results and then some possible next steps or some follow-on action items if this is at all interesting to you. As I think Jesse mentioned at the head of the call, feel free to type in questions. She'll keep her eye on the box. And if there are questions, then she'll interrupt me and go ahead and ask them, and we'll try and address them pretty much as they come up. Otherwise, there'll be an opportunity, I think, maybe halfway through, and then at the end, for sure at the end, to ask questions there. So let's talk about some of the reasons why people have used captive insurance companies. Certainly, wealth accumulation is a primary driver in this. We have numbers of clients who are operating successful businesses who are looking for ways to increase wealth, certainly cash accumulation for ownership, and a captive can be one way to do that. Definitely, owners are looking for tax savings for the company. This is a company-level program, so it's saving money for the company, but that, of course, in turn reduces the ultimate taxes to owners, whether it's a C-Corp and you've got tax at the corporate level, or whether you're a pass-through organization and your taxes are flowing down into the individual shareholder level. This is a technique that will help to reduce those taxes, both in the near term and the long term. For those who are interested, it can be a very interesting asset protection tool. There are any numbers of professionals who look at captives as a way to help protect assets. But I would say that we have a number of owners who are operating manufacturing facilities, or who are large general contractors who are worried about liability, and the captive insurance can be a great way to provide asset protection for them. Certainly, one of the things that we always look at is whether or not there's an opportunity to minimize outside insurance costs. So if we're working with a company who's thinking, you know, we've got certain types of coverage and we've never had any claims and we have really good procedures and processes in place for this particular item, maybe one of the things we want to look at is an increase in deductible and maybe shift some of that risk over to a captive insurance company. Another good potential benefit. That's not for everybody. It's not always the case that we can find insurance cost savings, but it's definitely something we want to look at in every case. Customized risk coverage is another area where a captive can be a benefit. Sometimes you want to have coverage. I may come back to this particular company, but we have one of our clients is a company that has business activities in some parts of the world that are very difficult, Afghanistan, Iraq, very dangerous places for their employees to work. It's very hard to get and very expensive to get certain types of insurance. What we've been able to do is to customize certain types of coverage for them combined with a reinsurer so that they get at least some of the kind of coverages they want, and they take some of the risk themselves, which, of course, if they couldn't get the coverage, is all on them. So we're able to design some coverages for certain specific situations that might otherwise be available, or if they're available, perhaps not affordable. And then finally, for some of our companies, wealth transfer is a big issue. They're looking at ways of moving value down into future generations, and this is a way that that can be done. Who are good candidates for this? Certainly, the best candidates are successful businesses primarily. We've also worked with professionals, though, physicians, architects, to a lesser degree, law firms. But primarily, I would say it's successful operating businesses, whether they're manufacturers or distributors or trucking companies. We've done some work in the oil and gas field. The key here primarily is that they're successful. They also will have some uninsured risk, and we'll talk about what some of those uninsured risks are. We have a relatively thorough, it's not even a white paper, it's really just sort of a list and a description of uninsured risk that we've run across over the years, and as part of our suitability process, one of the things that we'll do is go through that list with prospective candidates for a captive and see if they sort of self-identify with any of those risks. One of the other things that we're looking for is free cash. There are going to be some businesses who are really good candidates in this regard and some that aren't. We might run across a business who meets all four of these bullets, the three of these bullets, but the free cash is dedicated to growth or acquisition strategies. And so they're just, they're not going to be able to carve out $500,000 or $1 million or even a couple $100,000 in free cash for premium. So they might be desirous of a captive. They might be a good fit, except for this. And in that case, it's kind of a deal killer. Taxable income. Most of the people who are looking at this are looking at this as a risk management tool, but a significant driver is the reduction of taxable income. I know it's hard to believe, but not everybody has taxable income. A lot of real estate developers with lots of depreciation and other expense deductions manage to drive their taxable income down pretty low. A lot of operating farms, some of the more agribusiness type farms, same thing. So not everybody has significant taxable income. The only exception to this, I would say, I don't think there's recognize anybody on the call with this problem, but there is a significant amount of activity in the nonprofit world, particularly in the hospital space, as hospitals buy more and more physician practices and start to take on more of the hallmarks of an operating business. But still, they don't have any taxable income, but they're using captives. In fact, they're probably, I'd say, the biggest sector right now of growth in captive is in the hospital world, and again, it's because they're having to find most cost-effective ways of providing for liability insurance and professional insurance and that sort of thing. But that's probably, again, not a primary driver for most of the people on the call. Here are some examples of types of sectors where we've done work: developers, general contractors, subcontractors, electrical, people who work on very large projects. Manufacturers are great candidates for this type of work. I would say probably most of our clients that are in captives are in the manufacturing business. Professional services firms, as I mentioned before, can be good. Franchises, fast food franchises, hotels, restaurant chains, physician groups, and as I mentioned earlier, hospitals could also potentially fall into good candidates. Let's take a look at a quick case study. This is a client that we started working with 7 or 8 years ago. They're a manufacturing company. They're a C Corp based here in the Midwest. About $45 million in sales. I'm sure that's up. This is slide's probably a couple years old, but $45 million in sales at least. They have operations in and out of the country, 300 employees, give or take. That's probably a little less. They're doing much more with robotics, and I know they were growing and at the same time shrinking their employee base. So they're probably down around to 250 or 260 now. Pretty healthy net profit, about $6.5 million. And lots of insurable risk. As soon as you walk into their plant, you can tell that there's insurable risk everywhere. Interestingly enough, we had a big claim this year. We're not done processing it, so I can't report how it's working out, but maybe I'll come back to that. But they had about a $600,000 claim as a result of a recall item this year, and so part of that's looks like it's going to be covered by their captive insurance company. They had plenty of free cash, and they had plenty of, as I mentioned, insurable risks. So they were a good candidate, assuming that this is something that they wanted to look at. Here's another case. This was a much smaller case. This is an oil and gas services drilling company. They not only did a lot of work right at the wellhead, but they also had, I don't know, a dozen or maybe 15 trucks and drivers, and part of their operation was transporting their own product, but they also did quite a bit of trucking and transporting for other well diggers and drillers. About $5 million in sales, most of their operations located in the Midwest and the southwestern U.S., much smaller employee base, 22 employees. Net profit was still, on a relative basis, very healthy. Lots of insurable risks. In fact, some insurable risks that could have been catastrophic that we actually steered away from, particularly on the environmental side. And estimated premium to insure all these risks was over $200,000. Turned out that $200,000 was kind of their tolerance for premium, and so we looked for risks to insure that were appropriate for the business that fit their budget. So what's the takeaway from these two slides? I mean, both of these are profitable companies relative to sales. They're mature companies. They have free cash. They have insurable risk. And we were able to design a program that in one case resulted in a premium of about $200,000. I think they might be at $250,000, but you get the idea, around $250,000. In the other case, we probably could have found insurable risks and premiums well over $1 million. $1 million was their tolerance for premium, and so that's where we ended up with them. As I mentioned, I have a 13 or so page list and description of risk coverages that we have done. If anybody's interested in it, get a hold of Pete. He's got a copy. He can get it out to you right away by email, and we'll have his email address up on the slides shortly. But here are some examples: directors and officers liability, regulatory action. In the case of the trucking company, they've got a lot of regulatory oversight. They're doing interstate trucking of oil and some other maybe some natural gas. I can't remember. But this is all stuff that is subject to governmental oversight, and loss of license to operate in a particular area could be disastrous. Key person insurance, so we have a company that has a couple of key people who are intellectual property developers. Unfortunately, they didn't get them under confidentiality agreements when they first started out. They're quite valuable people to the business now, and they're refusing basically to sign any agreements. So one of the things we insured was they're leaving, whether voluntarily or involuntarily through disability or death or something like that. Business interruption insurance, some of these a client in the Midwest who's got a big manufacturing facility, a different one, is constantly worried that a hurricane or a tornado is going to blow through. I guess tornadoes going to blow through and take out one of his big metal buildings and who knows what with it. Confidential data, obviously a big item in this day and age. A lot of people are keeping confidential data like Social Security numbers and credit cards and that sort of thing as part of their sales process. Physicians obviously have lots of confidential data, so you could see where that could be a potentially big area to insure. So these are just a couple of examples of risk coverages that are out there, but when you think about your own business and you think about the things that you think could happen to you, those are going to give you some idea of where we might be able to explore alternative risk coverage through a captive. Now, I just want to look at couple of the converting some of the benefits that we talked about up at the top of the call, and convert that into some specifics with regard to the two cases. So remember, case one's larger manufacturing company. Case two is relatively small oil and gas related type business. So just in terms of wealth accumulation, and I think this is over a 4-year period of time, we've got about $4.5 million accumulated. In the larger case, about $850,000 accumulated in the second case. We've got really nice asset protection wrapped around this wealth accumulation. We've got tax savings on one side of about $800,000 and on the other side about $180,000. Some state tax savings as well. We've got annual premium savings. In case one, there wasn't any. In case two, there was about $21,000. And again, some of the numbers on the right-hand side may not look so dramatic, but I have to tell you that for the owner of this particular smaller business, saving $21,000 for him was almost better. On insurance was almost better than the tax savings. So it just depends on who your owner is and who you're dealing with. Wealth transfer, big issue here. That $4.6 million that you're looking at the top, that's money that passed to the kids without estate taxes. So in addition to the income tax savings, there's probably another $1.5 million to $2 million in estate tax savings. And that's just today as that money continues to grow. The estate tax savings continues to accumulate as well. In case two, and again, everybody's case can be a little different. He wasn't that interested in wealth transfer. We didn't do any. So you can see that it's not applicable in that particular case. What's our process for doing this? If you're come away from this call saying, some of those things look interesting to me, I like the idea of potentially shifting some risk, I like the idea of covering some types of risk in my business, I like the idea of maybe some income tax savings or asset protection or wealth transfer or whatever, what are we looking for? So the first thing we're looking for is financial qualification. Now, this is true for anybody who's consulting in this area. We're looking for, the types of things we talked about at the beginning of the call. Is there free cash to do this kind of a deal? Is there a willingness to dedicate that free cash to this type of a deal? Are there things in the future that are going to take away all that free cash so you wouldn't be able to commit to a program like this for a period of years? Not that you necessarily... Kim, risk assessment is something that we'll do at the beginning. We'll likely get an underwriter on the phone. We'll go through sort of a series of questions about your business to develop how risk assessment works. We'll do a cost-benefit analysis. So after you did all this stuff, what would it look like sort of on a pro forma basis? And then at that point, the business owner, or if it's a CFO who's kind of running this process, you know, makes a decision. This makes sense for us or it doesn't. This is not a long process. It's actually fairly quick, a week or two usually, if people are, you know, we're all diligent about it. We can pretty much get to an answer fairly quickly. So once that happens, if there's it's a yes decision, then we'll engage a manager. There are lots of captive managers. Certain managers specialize in certain types of things. Some are very experienced in the, for example, in a nonprofit hospital area. Others are working with pretty large companies, others with smaller companies. So what we're going to try and do is engage a manager that is a good fit for your particular company. We go into a more detailed underwriting review, which will generate an underwriting report. That underwriting report essentially lists the risks that we're looking at for your company. That'll go to an actuary who will essentially look at those risks, price them out, in terms of what premium is reasonable relative to those risks. And then it comes back to the business owner, or in this, if it's a CFO, or again, whoever's making this decision for the business. We're going to pick through the risks that are there and the pricing and the potential for exposure and figure out which ones make the most sense for your particular business. And then really once that's done, you're going to just be involved in forming a captive insurance company, capitalizing it, licensing it, making your premium payment, getting a policy issued. There's a lot more going on here than what I've got, but these are some of the big things that'll happen. Now, I'm going to actually, just given the time frame that we're in here, I'm going to probably skip some of these slides because I've mentioned a lot of the things that we're going to see in these slides. I've sort of done them. People that we work with want to know where their captive's going to be. For many years, most captives were formed offshore. Bermuda probably has more captives than any jurisdiction anywhere in the world. Nevis is getting close behind. But some things have happened with competition. You started to see much more happening in the U.S., and frankly, U.S. taxpayers are more comfortable in the U.S. Even though Vermont has got lots and lots and lots of captives, I don't know how many, but I'd say at least 500 or more. They're certainly the leading state in the country. They're also the most expensive state. And for many years, they just had no competition, so they were the only real alternative. But more states realize there's revenue here to be had for the state, and so they're starting to get into this game. Most recently, North Carolina has come in the last couple of years, and they have created a very inviting environment for the captive world. Their pricing is very good, very competitive. Their sort of rules and regulatory structure are the same. It looks very much like what you would find in Nevis at not much more of a price than what you get in Nevis. So I would say more and more U.S.-based companies are going to be forming in North Carolina, and probably going to see some of these other states that are probably going to be reacting to this competition and lowering their pricing. And so pretty soon I think most of the business will be done in the U.S. and hardly any of it will be done offshore. I'm going to skip through this one. Yeah, let's talk about this. One of the key things about captives is that in order for it to be a deductible expense to the business, the premium deductible expense, it has to meet certain requirements. First of all, it has to be, you know, an ordinary and necessary expense to the business. That's just sort of a general tax code requirement for businesses. But in addition to that, it has to be real insurance. It can't be sort of a fake type of insurance or, you know, just kind of a made-up thing. It has to be a real kind of a deal. If it's a scam, it's never going to pass muster. And so how do you know if it's real insurance? Well, there's no definition of insurance in the Internal Revenue Code. There's only a couple references in a couple cases that talk about this. But the basic idea with real insurance is that you have to have two things. You have to have risk sharing and you have to have risk transfer. So if you have an operating business now and you've got all the risk on your shoulders, then something has to change in order for there to be insurance. And so one is you have to put the risk off your balance sheet. So, you know, if you think about this, if you have your insurance with Aon or, you know, State Farm or whoever you might have it with now, you're shifting risk from your balance sheet over to the insurance companies. So you have to do the same thing. And again, that's not hard. That's relatively easy to do. But you also have to have risk sharing. So when you buy into a company like, you know, you get your insurance through Aon, they're basically doing the risk sharing for you. They're just like a giant insurance pool, and you put your premium in and your risk is in there with everybody else. Captive insurance works exactly the same way. So what happens is when you create a captive insurance company, some of the risk of your business is going to be put into an insurance pool along with the risk of other business owners. And you're all going to share in the profits if there are a few claims, and you're all going to share in the losses if there are claims against the pool. One of the good things is that these insurance pools tend to be pretty closely managed, and the reinsurance pool operators are definitely looking out for spurious claims and for things that shouldn't be paid, and they're very vigorous in their defense of the pool. I can tell you that from firsthand experience with this fairly large claim that I mentioned before. I don't want to say they're giving us a hard time at the pool level, but they're certainly being very diligent about making us dot all our I's and cross all our T's before any claims are paid. So that's a plus, but it's a requirement. If you hear someone talking about captive insurance that doesn't have some sort of a reinsurance arrangement, then probably isn't gonna pass muster. Just a little technical thing, but relatively important for small captives, like most of the types of captives that we're involved with. There's essentially a little piece of the Internal Revenue Code that basically controls this world. And what what's interesting is that they're basically saying that if your captive has less than $1.2 million in net premium, then the captive insurance company does not have to pay income tax on that premium. So what's really happening here is your operating company is paying a premium for insurance, so it gets a deduction. The captive insurance company takes the money in, but if it's less than $1.2 million in premium, it doesn't pay tax on it. So basically you're getting a giant tax deferral here. And then later on, there's going to be when money comes out of the captive, it'll come out at a dividend rate. So for most business owners, it's a 20 to 25% arbitrage on the tax rates in their favor. So there's usually a pretty good tax motivation for doing this. Again, most of the clients that we have plenty of insurable risk and lots of reasons to shift risk to a captive. But I guess I would have to say that taxes are often a very important piece of this picture. One of the questions that comes up is what can you do with the money that's in the captive? So let's just assume that your captive is operating profitably and you've got $1 million or $2 million or $200,000 or $300,000 or, you know, whatever level you're doing in the captive. Where can you invest your money? And there are some definite restrictions, particularly on first-year money. But Pete, if you're on the line, would you come in and just, this is more your area of expertise than mine, would you spend a few minutes and just talk about that?
Sure, and I don't want to get too detailed here, but what's important to know is that there are basically essentially two buckets with captive insurance assets. And the first bucket is the reserve bucket. And what's really important there is to keep those reserves safe. So a lot of times we deploy a bond strategy that will match bond cash flows with expected anticipated claims. So it's really important to keep the reserve bucket safe to be able to pay for claims. The second bucket is a account accumulation bucket. So it's safer there to get into a riskier strategy, you know, with prudence. to keep the account balance growing. So, you know, we deploy a structured asset class approach with a low cost, globally diversified portfolio of, you know, 9 to 12,000 equities across the globe. But it's a really prudent approach to capture the returns of capitalism over time, and then we tilt the portfolio depending on the circumstances of that particular client and their captive and what they want to do with it to pick up additional returns. But the important thing to know is that there are two buckets. One, you want to keep very safe and you want to match cash flows to expected claims, and the other bucket is intended to keep growing the account side. So that's, you know, that's basically it.
Great. Okay, thanks. I think a lot of people are interested in knowing sort of what the cost side is. I mean, we've talked about the benefits, what's kind of the cost structure for this. It's this is a ballpark idea that you have on the screen now. Generally, you could say between 7 and 10% of the premium amount is what you're going to see for costs, but there can be some variation both high and low based on the types of things that are being insured and the type of captive that you're in. So really that's, you know, if that's somebody looks at that and says, boy, I absolutely don't want to do that, but otherwise I'm really interested, I would say let's have a conversation about it. I can't guarantee that we could, you know, in your particular situation that we could bring the cost down, but this is a decent ballpark figure to be thinking about. So today we've talked about, you know, sort of the benefits of doing captives. We've talked a little bit about the type of people, type of businesses that might be appropriate, sort of what sort of the hallmarks are for an appropriate business. Looked a little bit at a couple of case studies. The subject, you know, has a lot more depth to it than what we've hit on today, and hopefully today was just a good look at some of the big concepts, kind of wet your whistle or wet your appetite for a little bit more. And if you'd like to, I guess the next step would be to call for a conversation, to reach out to Pete. We'll get something scheduled. He can get you a suitability questionnaire, which is probably about 7 or 8 questions, plus the long list of descriptions that we talked about. If you're not ready for that step and you just want to get some more information, you can go on the web and type in captive insurance and you'll find hundreds and hundreds of things. We've also done a series of short, in-depth, you know, fairly detailed videos at YouTube. If you type in InnoVision Captives on YouTube, you'll get to those videos, and they're all sort of distinctly titled, so you can look at something that might be interesting to you and watch that. And they're relatively short, 10 minutes or so for each one. So that would be a good source for information if you're not ready for a conversation. If you are, I've got Pete's information up here on the slides. You can reach him at pete@cypresspart.com, or his phone number here is 415-785-3635. Yeah. I would say operators are standing by, but that sounds that part I'm just kidding about. So hopefully this has been helpful, and we've enjoyed doing it. And what I think I might do, Jesse, is just stop for a quick sec, see if there are any questions. So we'll just open it up for questions. If there aren't any, we'll just come back and end up.
Okay, so just as a reminder, you can raise your hand to ask a question. I'll unmute you, and then you can ask it to the group, or you can type it into the chat box or the question box on the toolbar. So we'll give you some time to think if you have any questions. All right, well, it looks like you're good to go, Scott.
Thanks, Jesse. All right. Well, Pete, thank you for having me on, and thanks to everybody for joining today. Be happy to have a conversation with anybody to see if this might be a good fit. Look forward to that call. Thank you.
Great. Thanks for the great information, Scott.
Have a good day.
You too. Take care.